This is liquid metal, and I first heard about it while watching teardowns of the new PlayStation 5. In a nutshell, it sits between the CPU, or whatever is producing the most heat in your system, and the heatsink. And its job is to basically conduct the heat from one part to the other as fast as possible. Now you might be thinking, wait, don't we already have thermal paste for that, which does the same job and worked just fine for decades? And the answer would be yes, thermal paste does the same thing. But when it comes to how fast such a substance can transfer heat, then my used thermal paste only comes with a thermal conductivity of 8.5 watts per meter Kelvin, while the liquid metal features a conductivity of 73 watts per meter Kelvin, which is quite a difference. So the logical conclusion would be that liquid metal is superior and we should simply abandon thermal paste. But that conclusion is most of the time not true. And in this video I will show you exactly why by more or less playing around with liquid metal and doing a couple of tests. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by Keysight. Knowing how to use an oscilloscope is an essential skill, and Keysight University's Oscilloscopes 101 course teaches you everything you need to know to become an oscilloscope pro. Learn the basics, probing, and how to use advanced capabilities that will speed up your design and testing. Use the link in the description to sign up for Oscilloscopes 101. Or one or the other 100 engineering courses available on Keysight University. First off, let me tell you that getting liquid metal is not really hard. I got mine from Amazon for around 12 euro, which is more expensive than normal thermal paste, but I think still affordable. Now when opening up such a pack of liquid metal, then you are greeted not only with the syringe filled with metal, but also with two tips for placing the metal and removing it, a manual, two Q-tips for distributing the metal onto the surface, and finally alcohol pads for cleaning your CPU surface or similar, which I will not be needing. You also get a big fat warning letting you know that you cannot use liquid metal with aluminium heatsinks. Which is a shame because as a power electronics engineer, those are the kinds of heatsinks I have laying around the most. But just for fun, let's try it out anyway. And as you can see, after a short amount of time, the liquid metal reacted with the aluminium and turned into a crumbly alloy that will certainly not conduct heat well anymore. The good news for all power engineers though is that the liquid metal does not react with the exposed metal parts of MOSFETs or other power switches. That means the usage in power supplies is possible, if we would replace the aluminium heatsink in them. And in case you're wondering, even though liquid metal is obviously liquid, it sticks well to metal and thus should make a vertical mounting position possible. But enough with power electronics for now, and instead let's focus on computer applications of liquid metal for your CPU and GPU. Now I hate to disappoint you, but I'm not doing any tests with my workhorse computer, because I need it on a daily basis. And there are already great benchmarks out there on Gamer Nexus with CPU and GPU temperatures using liquid metal instead of thermal paste. Instead, why not do a comparison with a Raspberry Pi, of which I have a few, with the newest one being the Raspberry Pi 4, whose main chip even looks similar to a normal CPU. And best of all, you can even get such a cute little heatsink for it, onto which it should be possible to apply thermal paste and liquid metal. So my idea is to stress test the Raspberry Pi's processor without heatsink, with heatsink and thermal paste, and with heatsink and liquid metal, and then compare the temperatures to one another to see if there is a difference. To do that, I firstly installed the Raspberry Pi OS onto microSD cards, which I then plugged into the Pi before powering it up. Through the help of PuTTY, I then connected to the Pi in order to not only update its software, but also to install StressBerry, which is the amazing piece of software that basically automates the stress testing for me and will output such easy to understand graphs. And as soon as that was done, all I had to do was to type in a specific command in order to start the first stress tests. By the way, during all tests in this video, I always try to keep the room temperature at around 20 to 21 degrees Celsius, so that we can fairly compare the results. With that being said, here are the results of the first run, with a peak temperature of almost 80 degrees. To lower that, I completed the assembly of the mini heatsink, which I then secured in place on top of the processor after applying a thin layer of thermal paste onto it. After then plugging in 5V power for the fan, it was time for the same test as before, which according to the output graph lowered the temperature down to around 33 degrees, which is a huge difference to before. But now the problem is that with such low temperatures, we will probably not see a temperature difference with liquid metal, since the more limiting factor in such a low temperature setup is the heatsink design rather than the thermal conductivity between processor and heatsink. So what I tried next was overclocking the Pi, which initially worked out just fine, and bumped up the temperatures to around 36 degrees at a clock rate of 2 MHz. But while trying to go faster and thus reaching higher temperatures, my Pi always crashed and froze during testing. That is why for my last attempt, I simply unplugged the fan and went with the original 2 MHz overclocking again, which to my surprise also crashed, while it was reaching around 53 degrees. So without really any hope to see a difference, I removed the heatsink, cleaned it up, and of course only noticed at that point that it was also using aluminium. The solution for that problem was using my Dremel to get the aluminium away from the copper. And afterwards, I not only put a bit of painter's tape around the processor, but also applied the liquid metal onto it. In case you're wondering why the painter's tape protection, then let me tell you that liquid metal is actually electrically conductive. After testing this property for a bit, I can definitely confirm that. Which means that if the liquid metal gets misplaced, it can short components and or traces and thus fry your complete system. In my case though, the liquid metal didn't fry anything, and the Pi started successfully after mounting the heatsink and plugging in the fan. The first stress test I then did was with 2 MHz overclocking and active fan, which surprisingly this time also crashed, but delivered a constant temperature before that of around 36 degrees, which is pretty much identical to the thermal paste test. What was interesting though was that without the fan, the liquid metal setup reached a temperature of 50 degrees in around 8 minutes, while the thermal paste before only needed 5 minutes to get that hot. Seems like the better thermal conductivity transferred the heat faster to the heatsink, and thus gave the heatsink more time to emit it, meaning it reached the 50 degrees Celsius mark later. That doesn't sound too bad, but for a proper verdict, and to make my point crystal clear, let's do one last experiment with this transistor and this heatsink, which also comes with a fan. After drilling a hole into it and creating a thread, I first used liquid metal for the heat transfer between the transistor and heatsink. According to this very simple schematic, I then added a resistor and powered the transistor, which in this configuration now creates a heating power of around 16 watts. Next, I measured how hot the transistor becomes over a time period of 2 minutes. And afterwards, I cleaned up the liquid metal, which is actually easier to do than I thought before making this video, and applied thermal paste in order to repeat this exact same experiment. In this graph, you can see that the transistor with liquid metal was around 3 degrees colder at the start in comparison to thermal paste. But this difference shrank more and more over time, and at the end, both setups basically come with the same end temperature. And believe it or not, but this graph actually solves all liquid metal application questions for me. You see, according to the first temperature differences, it is clear that liquid metal really gets the heat faster from the components to the heatsink. But the end temperature clearly shows that for many setups that does not matter, because the heatsink cannot get rid of the heat fast enough, and thus is the limiting factor. So only if you have something like a processor with tons of transistors inside, which get smaller and smaller over the years, in combination with a well-designed heatsink, then it makes sense to utilize liquid metal to transfer the heat as fast as possible. For power electronics, on the other hand, it does not make that much sense, since the heat flux density is not that big, unless you're working with really high power stuff that even requires active cooling. So in the end, I think liquid metal does come with significant advantages, but also disadvantages, meaning the usage of it always depends on the kind of system you're working on. But I think, since you watched this video, you should now have a better idea of when to use it. If you liked it and want to see more, then consider supporting me through Patreon. As always, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!